hear the beep. Make sure it is recording. Okay, it's gone. Okay. Well, good morning. And here we are in session 15. And we're still on the fourth day. I'm hoping to get to the end of the fifth day today. Because it's been a busy week for me, and I just started on the sixth day, and so I haven't gotten much there. So hopefully we'll get to the end of the fifth day. Do you think? Doubt it? Okay.
Are you saying that'll push you to get done the sixth day if you get through the fifth day?
Yeah, if I get through the fifth day, then I have to get through the sixth day. So, but yes, I appreciate your patience and your continually coming back. So, David, could I ask you to open us up in prayer, please? Okay.
Father, Lord, we just thank you for another beautiful day, Lord, for this opportunity to meet around your word and to Lord, pray again with Jeff and the other teachers and the pastor as they're expounding your word, Lord, and may we listen with open hearts. So this gives in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right. Here we are again on the fourth day. Is this thing going to work? There we go. Fourth day, which is still with Genesis 14 through 19. We had been talking about the purpose of the lights in the heavens. It says for days and for years. I think we quickly mentioned last week how Samson Raphael Hirsch said that the Jews' catechism is his calendar, which pretty much is. A lot of it's based upon the feasts, the festivals, the timing of the year. For certain things to take place. And a lot of that was established in the beginning of the creation. They, in a sense, have a heptadic calendar, which is based upon sevens, or weeks. Like a week of days is the Shabbat. The week of weeks is a Shavuot. Shavuot? Did I say that right? Yeah. Week of months, which is the religious year. The week of years, a sabbatical year. They have 7 weeks plus one, which is 50 weeks, which is or 50 years is the Jubilee year. That's when all land reverts back to its owner, all slaves go free, all debts forgiven. The time of the restitution of all things is what Acts talks about, which they believe is pointing towards. Wouldn't it be great if the government just said after 50 years all debts are forgiven? You get your land back, you get everything back.
It'd be great if China said that.
Yeah, that'd be great. But of course, I don't think the Jews practiced this themselves, did they?
That's why they went
into captivity
for 490.
Yeah. 70, yeah, they were in the land for 490 years, and every 7 years they're supposed to let the land rest. They didn't, so 490 divided by 7 came out to 70. So that's why they're in captivity for 70 years, because they weren't obedient to this law. So. But it's based a lot of on sevens. And actually, they have two calendars, or actually two beginnings of a new year, in a sense. One in the fall and one in the spring. And this was after the Jews had left Egypt, after the Passover, their first Passover, where the death angel had passed over. And it said in Exodus 12:2, "This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year." If you take a look at the calendar, the old calendar, the first, began in Tishri, which to us is approximately September, October, and then it was reset after the time of Moses in the beginning, and then beginning to move into the wilderness wandering, and it was reset to Nisan, which was used to be called Abib or Aviv, and that's this time of the year. So this is the beginning of the sacred new year in the Jewish calendar, and in September it's the beginning of the civil year. And I think we even have the fiscal year starts in September, right? For businesses with accounting and that sort of thing. So that's kind of interesting. But so this is the new year for the Jews on a sacred year. So. Of course, we're talking about the fourth day, which was to give light to the earth. One of the questions that comes up a lot, and I think, Ken, you brought it up last week, and I've heard it a lot of times, from, for example, my father-in-law, who's a deist. He'll kind of ask the question, why would God make so many stars and planets but only put life on one of them? So I thought we'd cover that for a second. You may have seen this before. This is the Hubble Deep Field image. this is where the Hubble telescope, looking in one direction, they said there's this big black spot in this region here, and we think that there's nothing there. And they trained the Hubble telescope on that area for about 2 weeks, just exposing the lens, and then they picked up just millions and millions of galaxies in that region where they thought was nothing. So it's just incredible to see. It's kind of hard to see this picture here, but it's just incredible to think how much God did create. But that is a question that comes up. You know, if God made so many planets and stars, then why would he put life only on one planet? And of course, people who believe in evolution, they say that as a snide remark, to say that it just seems so odd, you know, this tiny little planet, this tiny little corner of the universe, and this tiny little part of the galaxy on this tiny little planet. Why would God make man just for there and nowhere else? Have you guys ever had that question come up? How have you guys answered that?
My answer was always, you know, you may be answering your own question. I mean, if you really stop and think about, well, how could it be that just one little tiny planet in the middle of nowhere amidst this big, huge universe was chosen by God? To me, the uniqueness is a sign of deliberate design.
Yeah.
And so to me, it's almost like they're answering their own question. That, yes, exactly. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
That to say that it is by nothing but accident, when we can look for into millions of galaxies infinitely in all directions and have no sign of life on a single one of them, is the point. That is the whole point. And if you miss it, you know, you can't see the forest for the trees.
Yeah. Yeah, and I read an article. It was from an evolutionist where they, I don't remember the term they used, but it's basically kind of what they refer to as passing through the knot hole. They think that there is a point at which evolution moves forward that it can either produce life or not produce life. And they think that it only has produced life on this planet itself, and where, of course, other evolutionists think differently. But I thought the article was very interesting that, just like what you were saying, they noticed the uniqueness of the entire universe. And, yes, I'm sorry, Dave.
Well, go ahead. I didn't come to finish what you were saying.
Well, that's one of the things that was so unique, or that they noticed, is that this universe is so unique, it does appear to be made exactly for man.
Okay. God, at this point in time, Lucifer fell, took part of the angels with him, and basically everybody was frozen into their spot. There was no more free will. And God created man so he could have free will and fellowship with him. He walked with him in the garden every evening. And God wanted people to have a fellowship with him out of their own free will. And so there's man. And God gives us every opportunity to fellowship with us and to enjoy his love for the earth if we will. And so I think, you know, God doesn't need man to fellowship with him.
Yeah.
But he wanted and loves our prayers and our study of his word and looks forward to our fellowship.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it does say, I can't remember which book it's in, but it says, here is eternity to have fellowship with the Son and the Father. That's, or to know the Father and the Son. That is eternity, is to know the Father and the Son. There's going to be a lot of other great, wonderful things in eternity, but getting to know the Father and the Son is going to be one of the greatest things to have that fellowship in heaven. So, yeah, I agree with that. To point out something here, I picked this up from Dr. Hoban. He's referring to Genesis 3:20. He says, "And Adam called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living." And, of course, the word Eve means life-giver. And there are some to believe that this refers to mankind being the only life form in the universe with body, soul, and spirit, which would exclude alien life, other life forms. Of course, the angels are ministering spirits, apparently not without, they can appear in a bodily form, but they don't have a body like us. But according to this scripture and what some scholars think, that this is making reference to the fact she's the mother of all living. She's the mother of, or Adam, of course, is the beginning of mankind. His name means man. And I think it's over in Hebrews chapter 1 that at no time did the Father say to any angel, "You're my son that I've begotten, sit upon my right hand." It was mankind that Christ had died for. And so I've heard others make arguments that Christ didn't die for some, he didn't die for the angels, he didn't die for some other alien life form, he only died for mankind, so that only mankind can be redeemed. So that's one of the arguments I've heard for there only being life here on this place. Yes?
Were you talking about Eve now?
Yeah, I'm sorry, okay. I'm kind of flip-flopping a little bit.
Dumb question. And, please forgive me.
I like it.
Good. I was thinking of the dumb question. Well, I know, but I've heard somewhere along the line that Eve was not the first woman, there was a woman named Lilith.
Yeah, that's a Jewish fable. Fable or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, supposedly, hopefully there's no children listening, Lilith was supposedly the first woman that God created out of the earth, and Lilith didn't want to be on bottom. She wanted to be on top. And God and Adam said, "I don't want her." And he said, "Okay." Then put her to sleep, and then took a rib from her so that the woman, Eve, would be subservient to the man. And then some fables say that Lilith was also the serpent in the garden. So it kind of... Have you ever watched Fraser Crane? What was that show that he was on?
Fraser.
His wife's name was Lilith.
Yes.
So anytime you hear the name Lilith in a television show, it's usually an evil woman. And it comes from that Jewish fable. So, yeah. It's not scriptural, but it's a Jewish wife.
It's Jewish.
Yeah, it's a Jewish mystic belief. Yeah, I don't remember reading it in his first few chapters, but yeah, but it is a Jewish fable, or they're one of some believe it. I think there's a lot of Kabbalists that believe that, but when I was watching the show Frasier, and I didn't think anything with the name Lilith, but when I ran across that story, I realized why they named her that, because she was cold and evil. But
told you it was a dumb question.
No, that's a good question.
And somewhat controlling, if I remember the character.
Yeah, very controlling. And then there was the point where the brother and her got together, and he says, "Whenever I kiss her, I get an ice cream headache." So yeah, that's what the name implies. So don't name your kids Lilith if you have any. Well, you can, but hopefully, I don't think any Jewish parents would name their kid Lilith. So, but this principle, this idea, has a place in science, and it's called the anthropic principle. This idea that this whole universe was created just for man. And if you like, there's a website called evolutionfacts.com. They named it that, I guess, to try to lure in evolutionists, because it does show the facts about evolution, which are the faults of evolution. But there's a evolution handbook. There's another book you can download or buy called The Evolution Cruncher. Some of the quotes that I've gotten and used, and even in my debate, came from some of this information. So, but there's a summary of this in the chapter 26 called The Anthropic Principle. Of course, anthropology is the study of man, and so the anthropic principle deals with the uniqueness of this universe just for man. Paul Davies, he's not a Christian, he's an evolutionist, but he's one of the newer intelligent designers. He's one of these guys like Michael Behe, I think even Fred Hoyle and some others, that are moving along in this movement called intelligent design, because as evolutionists, they believe that now there's enough evidence to show that the DNA molecule did not come about by chance, time, and the inherent properties of matter. So he's kind of in this direction of moving towards an intelligent design, and he says it seems as though somebody has fine-tuned nature's number to make the universe, the impression of design is overwhelming. And I think he's got a book out there called God and the New Universe, and it's an interesting read. And like I said, he's not Christian, but he's in that intelligent design movement, and it's a growing field that a lot of evolutionists are starting to come over toward, especially the molecular biologists. Because they're looking right down at the little tiny factories, and we're going to get into that. And they're seeing that there's no way possible that this could have come about by natural selection. It just couldn't have, not at all. But the anthropic principle basically says the appearance that the universe was designed for man, In constructing a mathematical model of what we believe we know about the universe, there are hundreds of delicate ratios that, if altered the slightest, would render life impossible. And some of these ratios are just as small as 1 divided by 10 to the negative 55th. So there's a lot of fine-tuning in the balance within the atoms, within the protons and the neutrons, and down into the quarks, that if you just tweak it just a little in its variation in the force, you can actually cause it to either pull in on itself or totally blow apart to where this universe would not even exist. So it's finely tuned for life here on this Earth at this corner of the galaxy. These are just a few of the things that that are, like, I think this one back here, it said, let's see, there are hundreds of delicate ratios. We're not going to go through all 100 of them, or hundreds of them. This is just one page of them. But you can see, like, for example, the strong nuclear force, if it were larger, there would be no hydrogen, which is essential for life. If it were smaller, there would be no other elements except for hydrogen. If you had a weak nuclear force, if larger, you'd have too much hydrogen, which would be converted to helium. If smaller, too little helium. And if you kind of go through each one of those, if you get into the science part of it and the math of it, if you see that you start tweaking these elements, you'll find out that they could not stay in their present state. They would be converted, which would then have an effect, a cascading effect, against all other elements. So it is like how Paul Davies said, it looks like everything's just finely tuned in its proper balance. Of course, I didn't include it in here, but there's things they also talk about, like our distance between us and the moon, the size of the moon, the rate of spin, the rate of angle of tilt that we have, our distance from the sun, the size of the sun, the type of sun, all kinds of ratios that they're starting to see that, hey, if any of this was tweaked out of, because in their minds, evolution's true, it all came about by accident. Well, the accident looks like a miracle, is how they put it. And I think even Francis Crick says that. I'll get into that here in a second. But that's just so neat to see that as we can continue to grow in this knowledge in science, we're starting to realize that, wow, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And God did all this just for us on this planet. Yes?
So the more that things show an imprint of organization and more of, order, those are the handiwork of the imprint of God as opposed to, randomness and, disorganization, chaos, which is the opposite of God.
Yeah.
So that means our mothers was right, right?
Our mothers were right.
Yeah, when she came in my room one time and said, "Needless is next to godliness."
Yeah. Do everything in order.
She said, "This is not God's room."
This is of the devil. Yes, David.
In the DNA opened up a lot of things.
And oh, yeah.
Like with the Mormons, there are a lot of Mormon scientists that are leaving the religion because DNA proves the Book of Mormon to be a big handcrafted part.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I had a long conversation with a gal that came to our house. She's my wife. Now that we're kind of exhausting all the doctors, we're looking for alternatives. And somebody had given her these things of oils to put on, and she's been using them, and she's starting to notice some help. But the lady who sold them to us or let us try them, she's a Mormon. And she didn't, of course, she didn't come out and say, "I'm a Mormon." She had a little ring on, I think it was on the right hand. It says CTR, choose the right. And my family, who are Mormon, the kids have that, and it means choose the right. And my wife saw that, and she realized what that was. And so she was there for 2 hours talking with my wife about the oils, and then I took another 2 hours talking to her about Mormonism. And I just took the stance of I'm inquisitive, I like to know. And a lot of the things that I had read about and always wanted to confirm with a Mormon who wasn't going to get mad at me when I asked the question, she confirmed a whole bunch of things. So she's pretty open and honest to tell me, and it's very, very interesting. We won't get in here, but it was just, but yeah, what you're saying is it's very interesting. And one person that I had read who witnesses to Mormons, he said the first thing with Mormons is you've got to get them lost. They don't realize they're lost. And so I was bringing up some contradictions between the Book of Mormon and the Bible and the Doctrine and Covenants and the Pearl Great Price and that kind of thing, just to ask, how do you reconcile those differences? So stuff. So, but again, she was nice and cordial. And again, if you ever want to witness to them, you can just talk to them. I think that's probably the best way to witness to somebody, just talk to them and ask them questions. Yes?
Would you say, by and large, that all the Mormons you talk to are pretty well trained?
So far, yeah.
So they do a lot. They do a real good job of educating their believers, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, she teaches, they call it seminary. She teaches like a 6 o'clock morning class for the kids. They go to that class before they go to school. And it's like a 45-minute class, and she teaches that. So, yeah, there's a lot of training that goes into it.
It's amazing how much the church has dropped the ball on that.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. I mean, I admire their programs that they have in place to make it family-oriented and all that. But, I mean, like I was telling her, the big differences between us are very big. So I admire, you know, that you're noble people, you seek to be honest, but of course all of that plays into their salvation. All of that works towards them climbing up to the celestial kingdom. I was asking her, well, where am I going to be? I'm going to be in the terrestrial. There's three levels of heaven. There's
Gnosticism.
Yeah, there's celestial, telestial, and terrestrial. And I'm going to be near the dirt, apparently. So, but I'm not going to go into outer darkness or something.
One thing we can learn from they're caring for their own.
Yeah, they do.
We lived in Ogden. It was a scientist that ran this apartment building where we were renting. And I asked him, was talking to him, and I said, well, why don't he was a bug guy, you know, trying to control insects. What are you doing here?
Yeah, they have their own welfare system. They have their own fields where they grow their own food. And if you're hitting on hard time, you can actually go out there and work. And work in the fields. And then they have their bishop storehouses. Because they're required to have at least a year's worth of food or half a year's worth of food or something. So, yeah, they've got some great programs. It's just, what's the driving force behind that? It's in my opinion, it's corrupt. So.
More and more, when they're running on welfare, it's up to you.
Yeah.
I mean, spent 3 days working for the city.
Yeah.
During the winter, they shoveled snow off the sidewalks downtown so the businesses didn't have to contend with it.
Yeah.
And in the summer, they policed the town for paper. You know, they got paper in the park. But you didn't get your welfare if you didn't work 3 days in the city.
Yeah. So it is interesting. They apply a lot of the biblical principles, yeah. But their interpretation of who God is and what salvation is just totally off. So, well, more on that somewhere down the road. But to end up, we're actually, this is the end of the fourth day, to talk about the purpose of the sun, moon, and the stars. This is actually, if we go back several slides, that's kind of what this started. Of course, Genesis 1, 15 and 17, it says, and let them be for lights in the firmament of heaven to give light upon the earth, and God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. I believe that the lights in the heaven are for giving light upon the earth, physical light, which is the sun, moon, and the stars, and I think also spiritual light, the signs, seasons, and the messages in the stars. So it's two kinds of light that I believe. And of course, the scriptures, there's tons of scriptures, even in the New Testament, that talk about, like for you and I to be the light of the world, like Matthew 4:16 says, the people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light has sprung up. Of course, that's when Christ came into the region. So Christ is the light of the world. He is the Word of God. He is the way, the truth, and the life. So I think the stars not only give physical light, but also spiritual light. So that's the end of the fourth day. Any questions? No? Okay. Moving on to the fifth. Huh?
Moving right along.
Don't slow them down. Fifth day. Would somebody mind reading the fifth day, which is Genesis 1, 20 through 23?
God said, let waters teem with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens. And God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after its kind, and God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day.
Okay. Just going to take a look at some of those words that were used there. Of course, life, referring to a living being having the breath of life. And this is actually the first time it's being used in Scripture. Some of the other things it's referring to back there when it refers to talking about the moving creature that hath life. In reading in one of my commentaries, when it talks about the moving creature that hath life, it said it was a swarm. And some scholars thought it was referring to bugs. Could be bugs, may not be bugs, not sure. But the way they referred to it was a swarm. Of course, bugs do swarm, like locusts will swarm. Oftentimes, fowl will also swarm.
Mosquitoes,
yes, that's coming up here real soon. So something, creatures that tend to swarm. Fish do swarm too as well. If you've ever seen them, they'll all kind of stick together. So
schools.
Yeah, a school of fish. So we got bugs, sea monsters, and fowl.
But isn't that swarm indicative too of same kind of creatures? In other words, when you see a herd of antelope running and so forth, they run together. They don't run with other animals. So wouldn't that be called a swarm of?
I guess it could be.
Call that a swarm of antelope?
Yeah, I guess it could be. Yeah. What other things swarm? People running into a football stadium, swarming, or running out, running out from church, after church, they're swarming out.
It's, I mean, like just like a marathon race. I mean, you have a like-minded people who want to come together and run.
Yeah,
is a swarm of runners.
Yeah, a swarm of runners. That could be it. Well, of course, we're created on the sixth day, so. But based upon what I studied, they said it's a swarm, and that's where some thought it was bugs. Of course, sea creatures and fowl, referring to birds and other flying creature. And then it also says the great whales. And if you look at the word whales, it's referring to a dragon, a serpent, or a sea monster. And that dragon is oftentimes used throughout Scripture, and it was oftentimes used in the ancient world to refer what we call dinosaurs. And we're going to get into, and I put in here more on dinosaurs later. When we talk about the ark, when we get to the great flood, we'll talk more about the dinosaurs and were humans with the dinosaurs, and if they were, how did he get the dinosaurs on the ark? You know, because did he really get the big ones on? Did he get the little ones on? What did he get on the ark? So, this is a separate type of life from that of vegetation, which we saw on the third day. No? Yes, on the third day. Also, this type of life is oviparous. They produce young by laying of eggs. That's what one scholar pointed out, because dinosaurs do lay eggs. Birds lay eggs. Fish lay eggs, right? Do bugs lay eggs? They lay, some of them lay eggs. So a lot of these are oviparous, laying of eggs. I didn't even know how to pronounce that word. I had to look that up. Point to make here with respect to evolution, here we see that God is the one that creates the living from non-living and not a blind natural process like evolution, because it says these were created out of the water. And that's one of the biggest problems that evolutionists have is how do you go from non-living to living? In my debate when we had with Beth, we were talking about, I think after reading back through our debate, she had said that evolutionists don't say that we come from a rock. But if you... I know she was talking about biological evolution, but I know if you translate back, there's a point where you have to decide, okay, how do you go from inanimate to animate? And a lot of times the way they describe it is that there was a reducing atmosphere, there was the rain raining down on the rocks, loosening the elements, then the primordial soup. So in essence, yes, we came from a rock, according to evolutionists. So, and I forgot to mention that to her. But everything, of course, also here in the scriptures, it said this over about the vegetation, but I wanted to bring this up here, where it says everything produces after its own kind. It does not morph into another kind, like from a monkey to a man. It's been demonstrated that DNA only maintains the kinds and does not change from one to another. You can have many different species of a kind, but it's still the same kind. And that's one of the big debates, at least whenever I've heard creationists and evolutionists debate, is this issue over the word kind versus the word species. They say that, you know, because they'll ask the question, well, how many dogs did Noah take on that ark? You know, because it's two by two, so did he take two Chihuahuas, two Great Danes, two of this, two of this? Well, no, those are all of the same kind. You know, maybe they can't reproduce because of height problems, but technically they could reproduce, you know, because they're of the same kind. So, and that's what this is referring to here. So when it comes to all the different types of monkeys, different kinds of cats, dogs, elephants, everything, they're all within one kind. Yes?
I am a firm believer that if you ask the wrong questions, you are sure of getting the wrong answers.
Yeah.
And you have to argue in the right arena. And I don't even argue kinds. To me, my general response to that is, define kind any way you want, and I will accept it, and we'll go from that point. The real question is, do fish become cows?
Yeah, I don't.
You can define kind any way you want, but it doesn't solve the basic problem of we got a fish and we got to make that sucker a cow.
Yeah.
If evolution is going to work, we got to do it.
Yeah.
And I'll pretty much give on anything you want to call kind. That's fine. Let's do it.
Yeah.
But that still doesn't solve the issue.
Yeah.
To me.
Well, I mean, when we were taught in school that it was some sort of sea creature who crawled out of the ocean and, you know, grew legs and over the generations became a cow. That was their response to how that happened. And, you know, which is, I always went, huh? No, I did enough to get past the grade, but I went, huh?
Yeah.
Well, generally, the illustration that they use along those lines is the is the illustration for a frog because of the metamorphosis that a frog goes through, because it goes from the tadpole to the frog by losing the tail and losing the gills and becoming an air breather, and that's a very popular one used as an illustration for that moving from the sea to the land.
Yeah, they also like to use I can't remember the guy's name, I just read it. It was the guy who drew out had to do with embryology, drew out the different embryos, and he had shown how every embryo looked the same, and they said that as an animal is being born, as a person is being born, they're going through those evolutionary stages. Well, it came out years later that the drawings he had drawn were false, until we got, you know, photographic evidence to show that what he was drawing was not exactly what was in the embryo itself. But that's still taught in schools, that how you are made in the womb, you go through the evolutionary stages of where you look like a fish or an amoeba, then a fish, and then an animal, and then a person, and then you lose your tail and all that kind of thing. But that's actually been proven false, but they still keep it in the science textbooks. I can't remember what it was called, but I think it had to do with embryology.
That's what it was. Did your mom swallow a rock and then it all happened?
Yeah. Yeah, no, don't swallow a rock.
Just what? Swallow what?
At what point does your mom swallow a rock? We came from rocks. Oh, that's part of the process, isn't it?
Yeah, you can start from the rock, and there you go. But this was out of the textbook is cited up top. It was Herbert P. Roeke and A.I. Operem, I can't pronounce it, from a couple of different sources. This is dealing with that the DNA, and these are evolutionary scientists. If you see the little stars next to them, these... out of this paper that I took it from, this is again off of Evolution Facts. It's off of their Science versus Evolution book, out of chapter 1. And what they do is, to just for the reader, they'll put a star next to the person's name to indicate if that was a creation or an evolutionist. So these are all evolutionists that are saying this. But it says Rosalind Franklin took some special photographs, which were used in 1953 by Francis Crick and James Watson, without giving her credit, to develop the astounding helix model of the DNA molecule. DNA has crushed the hopes of biological evolutionists, for it provides clear evidence that every species is locked into its own coding pattern. It should be impossible for one species to change into another since the genes network together so closely. It is a combination lock and it is shut tight. Only subspecies variations can occur, which is variations within plants and breeds and animals. This is done through gene shuffling. So here is an evolutionist looking at the DNA, studying it, knowing it, and he's saying the same thing that we're saying here, is that the DNA, all it does is it just locks an animal into its own kind. And I'm saying kind with respect to how the Bible defines it, as being it produces after its own kind and not another kind. Stephen Jay Gould was the one who proposed it. It was actually Goldschmidt who was the first one to propose it, but Stephen Jay Gould resurrected the idea of what they called the hopeful monster, or punctuated equilibrium, which was basically a dinosaur lays an egg and then a bird pops out.
Well, the DNA thing is kind of like a slam dunk then, isn't it?
Yeah, it is a slam dunk. And I've got a quote here from Francis Crick down the way.
Well, not according to our public schools,
though. Not according to the public schools, yeah. And that's the one thing that's frustrating, is that these scientists will tell this among in these peer-reviewed scientific journals. They'll talk about this, but when it gets to the marketing campaign that they do in the schools, they don't tell you this kind of stuff. They still have the horse evolution in the textbook. They'll still have the embryology in the textbook. They'll still have all this, you know, they'll Piltdown Man, Peking Man, Nebraska Man. They still have all that stuff, but it's been all this been disproven. But it's still in the textbooks. And that's when Dr. Hovind was debating an evolutionist. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's lies. And that's where I think you were talking about. There was a movement. Some school districts are doing it, and they're doing it across the states, is truth in textbook movement, where they're trying to show, look, this textbook that you're putting into your class, these sections here are false. You need to either go back to the publisher and have them take that out, or you need to put a disclaimer in the book that these things are false. And some communities did do that. They put a piece of paper in the front that said, on pages such and such, these have been proven false. So, yeah. But it is interesting that among themselves, they'll make this very clear, that this doesn't work, that it only locks it into its own kind. It produces after its own kind. But it is true, because one of the things they'll bring up is, well, there are varieties of bunnies now that can no longer produce with one another. And they say, see, the species is diverging. Well, technically, the gene pool is getting shallower. There have been too many mutations within it. And even on this one show I was watching, you can rent it on Netflix. It's called Atheist Tapes, if any of you guys have Netflix. It's called The Atheist Tapes. And they interview Richard Dawkins, who's wrote the book, The God Delusion. He's a biologist. He hates Christians, hates religion, hates it all. And he admitted in the video that most mutations they see are all harmful. They're downward. They're not upward. So.
But that happened in Tennessee.
What's that?
And doesn't that same thing happen in Tennessee?
It's about like the videotapes. You start making copies of videotapes, pretty soon it gets less and less and less.
Yeah, the degradation. Well, they actually found that, kind of along what you're talking about, they found that, you know, among the royals, and when they married among themselves, they had a lot of children. What's that?
Isn't that why hemophilia came about?
I don't know, did it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
It was in Egypt, and it was also in Russia.
Yeah.
And Rome.
Yeah.
Because they married the daughters and all that.
Yeah, they were, to keep the blood pure, of course, they produced a lot of kids with disabilities. Even Darwin, when he married his cousin, his first cousin, you know, if he didn't understand the DNA issue, married his first cousin, he had a lot of kids that were retarded, died young, died early, had severe disabilities. So, and it was interesting. I didn't find this out until I was reading through some of this material again. Darwin actually moved away from natural selection in his sixth printing of his book. Natural selection was basically the premise of for him for evolution, and he went back to what was called Lamarckism, and that's the idea of a giraffe, you know, trying to reach the higher branches as it stretches its neck out. That information is somehow carried on to the next generation, but it was disproven by the guy who was cutting the tails off of the rats for 19 generations, and every generation had a tail that was born. Of course, if he read his Bible and would have looked at the Jewish nation for over 4,000 years, they've been doing circumcision all that time. And every generation had to keep doing circumcision. So he fell back into something that has also been disproven. But he did so because out of pressure from his peers that were telling him, this is all bunk. And he, every edition he wrote, he was trying to anticipate their criticisms, and it actually took his health down considerably. But when he gave up natural selection, went back to Lamarckism, his health improved. But that, again, that's there's a book called the Secret Sixth Edition that not too many people talk about. So, yeah, he said he had to leave a little early. So, where are we at here? Oh, we're getting time. Also, in 1981, Sir Francis Crick, the discoverer of DNA, published a book called Life Itself, which totally repudiated evolutionary theory as unworkable. This is the guy that got the Nobel Peace Prize for discovering the DNA molecule. So you think this is the guy that would really understand the DNA. He said, declaring that there were absolutely no scientific evidence supporting it, Crick stated a new theory, which was even more fantastic. Living creatures had arrived on planet Earth, seeded by aliens from a distant world. His evidence was the fact that life itself is so astounding that it could never have originated by chance. And he said also in the book, an honest man armed with all the knowledge available to us now could only state that in the same sense the origin of life appears at the moment to be almost a miracle. So many are the conditions which would have had to have been satisfied to get it going. So here's the guy that understood the DNA molecule, understood its significance, understood its operation, and he realized this is the death knell to evolution here. But he's not going to give up evolution. So what does he say? Aliens planted us here. It's called panspermia. Is that mentioned here? The term that he coined was panspermia, meaning that we were seeded here by alien life. And there was even a movie that came out called Mars, I think it was, where there was life on Mars, and then there was a cataclysmic event that took place, and then they seeded the Earth, and they came back. Yes, I'm sorry.
What astonishes me, maybe it does other people too, but this government is still pouring money into shooting rockets into space. You
know? Yeah, to look for the life elsewhere.
And to me, that's kind of asinine. You got people starving to death, and then you got people shooting rockets into space to try to perpetuate life on other planets.
One pastor I know, Mike Baldia, he said, deception is well financed, but the truth is on a shoestring budget.
Isn't that funny?
And that's right. The truth. Yes.
But you got to take all the scientific advances that space exploration has given us. You wouldn't have computers, a lot of the computers, smaller, watches, all this stuff. I think God is. I think man looks for challenges, and that's it. Once you get across the country, where do you go? We went across the United States. Well, the only place you can go basically is down in the seas or up in the air. And I just think that I think it's one of God's plans for us to do that. I don't think we'll ever find or looking for other species and other planets. But God's God. How do you know?
Well, every branch of science except for evolution was founded by a creationist. And even Isaac Newton, he says when he does his scientific research, he's thanking the Creator's thoughts after him. That's what motivated him to understand the creation. So,
just like this Hubble telescope, seeing all these things in space that God created.
Yeah. I don't have a problem with science. I don't have a problem with the advancement of science. My problem is when they start to push these lies as being the means through which all this occurred.
I agree.
That's where my problem is. I love science. I love space exploration and stuff, but when we're spending trillions and trillions, we're spending a lot of money on trying to do some research that has proven itself over and over again not to be true, you kind of think, why don't we move in the direction that would actually show some benefit? Like with what Dr. Carl Ball was doing with the hyperbaric chambers, with the increased magnetic fields and stuff. Actually, NASA called Dr. Carl Ball because of his hyperbaric chamber experiments to see how they can employ that into space travel. How to better facilitate the astronauts to keep them healthy while they're going out into space. So here's a creationist researcher who's showing benefit Or like the sonic bloom technology that I had showed you. I finally got my stuff, so I'm going to try that. But he had shown just by studying the pre-diluvian world, before the flood, we could figure out how God did it, and we can replicate it and get some pretty cool advancements. But because it's based in creationism, nobody wants to touch it, which is, it's sad to me. Yes?
Well, basically, I think it says the devil, the idea is because they'll pray in Congress, they know most of those old fossils won't pay attention anyway, it's not going to change them, it's not going to hurt anything. But they took it out of schools because there are young, impressionable children there. And it's the same way with these things, you know, there are a lot of adults and they're going to make any difference.
Yeah, we're going to die.
We can tell them what the truth is and they won't do anything about it, but we got to convince these young kids of the lie.
Yeah, yeah. That was why Hitler did all the youth camps and the soldiers, because he understood if you can capture the youth, then you can change the next generation. So. But anyway, this is the chart that I was talking about, where you got many species of dog, but it's all still a dog. And they'll be critical and say, well, how did he get all, you know, two of this kind, two of that kind, two of that kind, two of that? That had to be a really huge arc. Well, no, all you need is just two of the original kind, because then it can produce all the variations. Same thing with of course, this is what they believe, you know, going from a lower form to a higher form, but this doesn't happen. And thankfully, as time, you know, when Darwin was postulating his theory, he didn't know if these existed, but he hoped they existed. He knew that the difficulty of proving his theory, he knew that the validation of his theory would be proven if they found all these different intermediary links. But the problem is that we haven't found them. And even Dr. Colin Patterson, who is head of the British Museum, he had gotten up and given a speech to several evolutionists, and he had asked them the simple question, can anyone tell me anything you know that is true about evolution? Any one thing. And he got nothing. And then he went to the Chicago Symposium of Morphology Scientists and asked them the same question, and it was silence for a long time, and somebody said, well, we know that it shouldn't be taught in school. And he said, I've been studying this stuff for 20 years, and all I get out of it is that we shouldn't teach it in school. He said, evolution, I'm finding, is anti-knowledge, it's anti-science, it's anti-everything. Because none of these, and he's the guy that holds the fossils that supposedly these are. And he says, these don't exist. He even wrote in one of his books called Evolution, he had written about supposed transitional forms, but he didn't show any illustration. And then there was a Christian writer who wrote to him and said, how come you didn't put any illustrations in your book? He said, well, if I did, that's just conjecture. We don't see any transitional forms. And he says, basically, I'm telling you, there are no transitional forms. We have no transitional forms. Those things that were called transitional forms have either, they were false, they were miscategorized, or they were just misunderstood.
Did you get this picture from Planet of the Apes?
No. No, I got this off of Dr. Hovind's. Why, was it look like Planet of
the Apes? Kind of bring out Planet of the Apes.
Well, they have, you know, like Homo sapien means wise man, and then they have Homo sapien sapien, which means the wise man. So we're now the wise man. And it's funny, you think of scripture, wise, they profess themselves to be wise, they became fools. So it's kind of funny. But anyway, also, Dr. Henry Morris, who is a creationist, in his Defender Study Bible, it's a nice Bible if you want to get it. You can get it from some of these, like Answers in Genesis or Dr. Dino. He said in this section here, he said, it's significant that the word create is applied to the introduction of animal life, but not to the plant life. Plants are highly complex, replicating chemical systems, as are animals. However, animals possess another entity, that of consciousness, which plants do not possess. Such consciousness is the essential meaning of the Hebrew word nephesh, commonly translated as soul of life and living creature. So yes, plants have a body, animals have a soul and a body, but man has a body, soul, and a spirit, and a consciousness of God. So, at least that's the way Scripture seems to apply.
I watched yesterday on television, they were talking about, they were showing pictures of all these animals, dogs mostly, you know.
Yeah.
And these are horses and things of that nature, you know. And they were starving to death, they were being maltreated, you know. And they were asking people to send money, you know, for the Humane Society.
Yeah.
to save animals just before, you know, and if they die, they're going to die, they're going to go back to the ground, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, there was...
They must have had a really good thing with the feed the children, because they're using basically the same things for animals and for dogs. They had this guy with this dog looking really sad and give all this stuff. It's dog.
Yeah.
My gosh.
Pull your heartstrings.
Gee.
Yeah.
I gave it to kids before I do dogs.
How come they don't do that for bugs?
Oh, did you hear that? The UN now wants to treat plants and bugs
as
same rights as humans. Somebody's proposing that in the UN.
Is that right?
Yeah, I know. But what happens if a mosquito bites you? He's trying to eat you.
That's true.
Then you got to go to court. But probably by the time you get to litigation, the mosquito will be dead. Sorry. But yeah, it's interesting. The founder of Hand to Help Ministry from Romania, when he was exiled here to America, he came out to California, and they were looking to try to find apartment to stay in, and he found places where you could have dogs but no children, and he said, what kind of country is this where you can have a dog but not a child? What is wrong?
We're talking about waste. Billions of dollars are spent on dogs every year. Billions.
Dog food. Look at all the dog food is sold.
I mean, it would boggle your mind.
So it's a big industry. But anyway, moving on, life from inanimate to animate. In his final chapter, as he reviews his reasons for calling his book Evolution, A Theory in Crisis, Dr. Michael Denton, who is an evolutionist, makes the following statement. He says, we now know as a result of discoveries made over the past 30 years that not only is there a distinct break between the animate, the living, and inanimate or non-living worlds, but that is one of the most dramatic in all nature, absolutely unbridged by any series of transitional forms or missing links. And like so many other major gaps of nature, the transitional forms are not only empirically absent, but are almost conceptually impossible. Again, he's basically saying that it's just impossible for these transitional forms to exist. And this is an evolutionist who's saying this.
He's still an evolutionist, right? I mean, persists.
I think he moved into what's called the ID movement, where he does believe in an intelligent designer. But they still believe that the intelligent designer used evolution to bring these things about. Sorry, go ahead.
Is your garden variety brainless oaf evolutionists, do they no longer purport any transitional forms? I mean, will they say that, or will they have some that they try to purport as being genuine, but we hold an opposing view on their validity?
Well, for the folks that I've talked with who are evolutionists or atheists that believe in evolution, they still believe that there are many, many, many transitional forms.
Okay.
They still believe that that's the case.
Okay.
Now, some of them who are moving a little ahead, they'll say, well, yes, we have the transitional forms, but it's kind of like when you say the alphabet, you got A, B, C, D. They say, well, we got A, then we got P, then we got Z. But the funny thing is that you don't know if P is in line from A to Z. They just suspect it is. But then when you get to the scientists who study this stuff, Colin Patterson, Michael Denton, Francis Crick, they're saying, nope, there are none. But yeah, it's not filtering down to the, and they don't want it to, because they don't, and that's where I was getting ready to say earlier, where Dr. Hoven was debating an evolutionist, a professor, evolutionary professor at a university. He went through and showed that there's no transitional forms, showed it over and over again, and then finally the doctors there, the professor said, well, Dr. Hoven, what do you think we should share with the kids then? And he said, why don't you share the truth? And he didn't have anything to say. Because they're...
Are you kidding?
Truth? Are you crazy? So yeah, that's one of the things why it's very difficult now for creationists to debate atheists and evolutionists, because they realize the results have been they've lost students, they've gone to that side, they've questioned the professors. So there's not a lot that we'll debate anymore. So
makes you really wonder where the separation of church and state argument truly lies.
Yeah.
And the reasons behind it.
Yeah. Because I believe that evolution is a religion. It may not look like our religion, but it is a religion. And they hate that. But it's a state-funded religion. Ours is not state-funded. Theirs is state-funded.
Yeah, but if you didn't have the separation of church and state, then creationism would be openly, there wouldn't be no barrier to creationism in the school.
Technically, there is no barrier. According to what, from some of the research that I got from Dr. Hoven and the people he's worked with, there really is no barrier. It's up to each school board district whether or not to allow it. It's actually up to each teacher. But if the teacher is told by the principal you cannot teach it, then they can't teach it.
No, it's
the fear and the fear.
A lot of it's rooted in the Supreme Court decision against the Gideons in Rensselaer, Indiana, where the Supreme Court decided that the Gideons could no longer. At least in the state of Indiana, can no longer distribute their Bibles. As a result, it takes that source of literature out of the schools in Indiana. And the teachers, as a employee of the state, cannot use it as literature, because then it would be promoting. It would be violating the separation of church and state.
Well, I'm not talking about teaching the Bible.
No, but
we're talking about teaching creation.
Right, but
which can be taught.
But that's where it leads is to if you get creation, you have to.
But that's what the ACLU constantly argues about is
right.
You're trying to get God into the school.
Right, but if you've got creationism, you've got to name the creator, and then you have to.
Not really, because intelligent design does not argue which creator. They just argue for the fact that there is an intelligent designer.
Right, but that's the normal step. That's the stepping stone that they want to prevent.
I know.
Is that. So.
But my point is, according to current law, at least what Dr. Hoven was talking about, it can be taught, but most school districts will not because of the threat of a lawsuit.
And they don't
want to fight that, and they don't want to spend the money for that, and the principal just doesn't want that headache.
But you've got to stay completely away from the Bible, completely away from all biblical accounts in the state of Indiana.
You actually can teach the Bible as an historical book. You just cannot promote it as a religious book.
You can teach it also. Perry Township has religious education.
Yeah.
And it's fourth or fifth grade, I think. And they take the kids out of the school. And then to another building or a trailer or whatever.
Yeah, they have to take them off the school property,
but they still can teach it. The school says you can't, you can't do it. You
but the teachers can't be paid by the state while they're doing it. They have to volunteer.
It's correct.
That's why I'm saying. You can't teach it in the school.
But you can take kids out of the school and teach them.
That's not the argument here. The argument is that it has to stay out of the school.
A lot of schools have prayer now in school.
Well, a lot of schools have not backyard Bible
clubs. Bible studies.
Good news clubs.
It can't be led by somebody that's an employee of the state.
Teachers are there. They're very talented.
They have to be doing it in non-paid, off-duty time. Because, go back and read the 87 decision.
And we could argue this forever.
Yeah, there's ways to get around it.
But
there's ways to go outside of the corporation to do it, which you are correct. But you can't do it with state paid on state time.
Yes, I'm sorry, Dave.
I've always gotten in some schools with puppets and stuff like that, and concerned about this. She had asked the teacher what she could do, and the teacher would say, "Don't tell me what you're going to do."
Yeah.
And then I can say, "Well, I didn't know."
Yeah.
And so she.
Forgiveness is easier than permission.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, anyway, we've kind of hit our 8:15 mark, and we didn't get to the end of the fifth day.
Did we sabotage you?
We're close, though.
Okay. Do you need 3 more minutes?
Let me see.
They're often late over there in the service, so.
We go out there and stand around for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Where did we go? Okay. Yeah, let's run through this real quick. Back in 1818, Bishop William Paley, he had wrote, "The watch with its gear springs and other mechanisms can never arise by the action of random chance." But then David Hume in actually before him, 1779, said living systems only have the appearance of machines unless it can be proven that living systems are indeed machines at the molecular level. Then Paley's watchmaker argument is irrelevant. Of course, now we've shown that they are. Richard Dawkins, in 1985, he wrote a book called The Blind Watchmaker, which was mocking Paley. He said in his book, the only watchmaker in nature is the blind forces of physics. A true watchmaker has foresight. He designs his cogs and springs and plans their interconnections with a future purpose in his mind's eye. Natural selection, the blind, unconscious, automatic process which Darwin discovered, which he didn't put in here that he later abandoned, and which we now know is the explanation for the existence and apparently purposeful form of all life, has no purpose in mind. It has no mind and no mind's eye. It has no plan for the future. It has no vision, foresight, no sight at all. It is the blind watchmaker. Well, of course, like we said, modern biology has revealed that even the simplest organisms are complex machines beyond our imagining. Science has refuted Hume and Dawkins and totally vindicated Paley. Sir Fred Hoyle said the speculation of the origin of species turned out to be wrong. That was Darwin's book. It is ironic that the scientific facts throw Darwin out but leave Paley the ultimate winner. And of course, some evolutionary fallacies, self-organization violates the law of entropy, which they say in the second law of entropy has nothing to do with biological evolution. Untrue. Complex system assemblies require all subsystems to be functional for a system to survive. This is the concept known as irreducible complexity. And it's kind of like the mousetrap. A mousetrap is irreducibly complex. If you take the spring out, it won't work. If you take the base out, it won't work. If you take the clip out, it won't work. Everything has to be there. Well, when it comes to our cells, there are millions of pieces and parts that if you take one piece out, the cell starts to break down and doesn't function anymore. So it's irreducibly complex. Well, if evolution were true, that means it had to happen all at once at the same time. Well, mathematicians who calculate probability and, you know, with respect to how do these things come together, they have proven mathematically that evolution is untrue to even form some of the simpler proteins and the enzymes, and especially the DNA molecule. It's completely impossible. You would exhaust all the atoms in the entire universe, because every time you have a reaction, a chemical reaction, of course you have the combining of the molecule, but then of course you have given off energy in the form of heat, which cannot be reclaimed, which is what the second law of thermodynamics deals with. So in other words, you'd use up all the energy in the universe just to try to make one protein by accident. It doesn't happen. Of course, going through quickly, when you talk about the hierarchy of design, if any of you guys are engineers, you probably understand this. Our form of design now, we've gotten to intelligent machines with respect to computers. We're getting up to the point where we're having self-programming systems and self-diagnosing systems. I have some systems at work that will constantly diagnose themselves to try to figure out, is there a possible problem that will occur? But it's not yet to the point of self-repairing. It has to tell me what it needs to be done.
You have self-parking Ford trucks here.
Huh? Yeah, you're getting closer. But we still don't have any self-producing systems or self-reproducing systems where they're remaking themselves. But of course, the so-called simple cell constantly remakes itself, all those intricate parts, within a few hours. So we have these incredible machines that Hume had said, you know, unless you can prove down at the subatomic level or the lower levels that it's complex as that of a watch, then yes, maybe, but no, there's no proof. Well, the cell is far more complicated than a simple watch. Far more complicated. It's self-reproducing. It's far beyond what the watch can do. So clearly, it's an intelligent machine that God created and not evolved over time. Some things with respect to the simple cell, its unparalleled complexity and adaptation design, has a central memory bank, assembly plants and processing units, repackaging and shipping centers, robotic machines, the protein molecules. It takes about 3,000 atoms just to make each protein molecule in a 3D configuration, hundreds of thousands of special types, elaborate communication systems with quality control and repair mechanisms. Michael Denton said in 1986, all of the tiniest bacterial cells are incredibly small. Each is, in effect, a veritable micro-miniaturized factory containing thousands of exquisitely designed pieces of intricate molecular machinery made up of 100 billion atoms, far more complicated than any machine built by man and absolutely without parable in the non-living world. And this is a quote from Francis Crick, the founder of the DNA molecule. He says, an honest man armed with all the knowledge available to us now could only state that in some sense the origin of life appears at the moment to be almost a miracle. So many are the conditions which would have had to have been satisfied to get it going. So even an evolutionist who still clings to an evolutionist point of view can admit it's a miracle.
In five.
There we go.
So we're just sitting here, miracles.
We're miracles.
God's miracles.
You have been fearfully and wonderfully made. And science can prove it too.
Right.
So, I used to have a list on a business card of all the chemicals that are in the human body. And the total dollar amount is something like $27.50 or something. And you can go down to the hardware store and buy them all.
Yeah.
And I have yet to find anybody that can put them together and make it brilliant.
Yeah. There was one guy, I can't remember his name, but he wrote a book. I think it was called Tornado in a Junkyard. And it refers to the fact that just the same as what we see in the structure of the DNA molecule, for that to come together by chance would be equivalent to a tornado running through a junkyard and assembling a 747.
Yeah, pretty much.
The probability for both of those to occur is about the same. Which basically means it's impossible. It had
it's
to
like
be designed.
It's like Elvin, what's his name? I can't remember that guy's name. But about working for an automobile company and it's taking parts out of this factory, you know. And
yeah.
Made a car.
Yeah.
Made a Cadillac. But it was all different kind of parts. It looked really weird.
So, any questions? I know we're running a little over, but that gets us to the end of the fifth day. Now I got a lot of work to put together the sixth day.
We wanted you to have to work this week.
Yeah. Well, I'm on vacation this week, but shh, don't tell. We're the kids don't know. They didn't even see the suitcase in the back of the car. We're going to go to Great Wolf Lodge.
Oh, no.
We came up with a story if they saw it, but we told them when we get home, you're going to start cleaning the room. We're going to start spring cleaning. We're going to do this, and we're going to head down to Great Wolf Lodge for a few days. Great Wolf Lodge.
Where's that at?
Big Water Park, Cincinnati, near Kings Island.
So.
We do that every time. When we went to Disney, we went to the airport. We said, we're going to take Mama and Papa up there. And then we got out, and they said, let's go. And they were trying to get back in the car. They're like, no, we're going. So we got to fool them. So I'm sorry, yes?
Anybody that is still after 3 weeks praying with me about this new job that I'm trying to sell, I am to call this guy tomorrow after him asking me, hey, I'm going through a divorce, it's all messy and nasty, please give me a week. Well, tomorrow is the weekend I'm supposed to call him. So if you're still praying about it, thank you. Don't abandon me now.
Still praying for you.
Thank you.
Still praying for you. Okay.
I'm calling tomorrow midday, some 11 to 2, something like that. And hopefully we'll at least be in a position where we can pick up and keep going.
Okay, cool. Well, can I ask you, would you mind closing this out for me?
Sure. Dear Lord, thank you for the chance to come in here and listen to your word be taught. Understand and pursue the truth. Thank you for the chance to be here among the Christians. Thank you. Take us all home safely and help us to enjoy the service you have to come in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thanks, guys. There, we're moving forward.
I'm going to have to find that formula.